Welcome back to Explain to Me Like I'm Five, where we're making it easy for you, explaining crypto concepts in simple terms and answering the questions that we've all been asked by family and friends about crypto. I'm Jessica Walker, and on this episode, we have Kevin Murcko, CEO of CoinMetric Exchange, and Scott Melker, Wolf of All Streets, both parents who will be explaining Bitcoin to their kids. Before we start, guys, make sure to like the video. First, let's jump right in with Scott. Scott, how does Bitcoin work?
What I've found myself doing, which is really fun, is I've started to play Monopoly with my six-year-old daughter. And what I did to start explaining to her more about Bitcoin was that I got rid of all of the money in Monopoly and made us transact and keep a ledger of the transactions of the game. So every time someone buys something, we take it off their written, you know, we do this written and we take it off of their ledger. If somebody, hits free parking or something, we add the money. So we're keeping this list of transactions. And when you do it with more than two people, it's a lot of fun. And obviously there's challenges to it. Like you have to make sure that nobody's cheating, adding a zero, anything like that. So basically what we do is we each keep our own ledger. And then every 10 or 15 minutes, we go in and we make sure that the ledger is correct. And I find this to be a perfect analogy for a child who can understand the game of Monopoly for what Bitcoin is and how the blockchain works. Obviously, you have the payment records, which is like a block, and then you have a network of all of us sharing it, which is each of our individual ones. And then every time we do a checkpoint at 10 or 15 minutes, that's sort of like a block being confirmed. And the fact that we have multiple people shows that there's no centralized authority, it's decentralized and it's peer-to-peer. So I've found that playing the game of Monopoly without the physical money has been the simplest way to start explaining to my kids and her friends about Bitcoin.
And this is where the phrase peer-to-peer really comes in. Unlike a normal game of Monopoly where there's one banker in charge of everything, this is known as a central authority and how the banks that we're used to now really operate. The way Scott plays Monopoly is considered decentralized. Everyone is checking each other's work and also everyone knows what the score is at any one time. You can't change the score without convincing everyone you're playing with that there's a really good reason for doing so. In a similar way, each piece of information that's recorded on the blockchain has an identical copy of the information. And that's pretty much set in stone. It can't be changed or tampered with. So it's impossible to cheat Bitcoin. The people have a huge role to play with checking each other's work and also making sure the system keeps on running. They also have another role, and that is to ensure new Bitcoins keep being created. But how can they do this if Bitcoin is this internet money that we can't hold or keep in our wallet? Well, new Bitcoins are created by Bitcoin mining. And the easiest way to think about cryptocurrency mining is to think of it as one interactive online game that you play on your computer. The prize in this game for solving puzzles is more Bitcoin. Kevin has explained it in such a way even his five-year-old understands.
From the technical side of it, it's kind of like an Easter egg hunt. So you're running around, you know, you're a miner, so you're trying to find blocks that you can then decode. So you're trying to find areas of the map where the Easter eggs are, and you decode them, and if you decode them well and you find that Easter egg, you get a prize inside, and obviously that prize would be Bitcoin. So she sees all these people interacting on electronic devices. And so understanding that the way these coins and her games are created is that every one of those devices is constantly searching for those coins. And when they find a box that they think there might be coins in, they have to open that box. And these boxes are digital, so you don't open them with your hands. You open them with your tablet, with your device. Your device goes in the background and does all these great computational things. And when she asked me what computational would be, I would say, well, that's stuff computers do. And they digitally open the box. And sometimes in that box, you will find Bitcoin. And what's Bitcoin? Again, it's money. It's those coins in your game. It's how you buy things on the internet.
That was a really good explanation for how you would talk to a child about it. And if you're going to say, how do I do it myself? Well, there are a number of ways, but at the end of the day, everybody just needs a computer, an internet connection, something that we largely all have. And, you know, the willpower and patience to become a miner, it's really become something that's so accessible for almost anyone through various, different companies and methods. But at the end of the day, it's just what he said. If you're going to explain to a kid how Bitcoin is made, you say it's a really complicated puzzle that only computers are smart enough to compute and solve. So you have to get a computer and you have to get them working together to try to solve that puzzle. And when you solve the puzzle, you get a reward. And so at the end of the day, for a child, I think you know, giving the analogy of, hey, it's just it's a math problem like you do in school, or it's a puzzle or a game that you play and you want to win the game and then you win Bitcoin. I think that's the most simple explanation.
So now that we've covered blockchain technology and why it's really important for Bitcoin, we know how Bitcoin is made, but it's so important to understand why this new technology is so important. So once you understand the core features of Bitcoin compared to paying on a credit card or the cash in your pocket, you will not want to look back. Scott, I want to ask you, what do you think?
In general, our kids see us order things on Amazon and they see us use our credit cards and they see us pay people through PayPal. So I think that that's really the bridge, and they understand that money is effectively digital already and that cryptocurrency is just a superior next step. When I was a child and I started listening to rap music and my parents would tell me how much better the music of their generation was, the songwriters were better, the stories were better, they played real instruments. And of course, I was a DJ for 20 years and a music producer. So, you know, I went a completely different way than my parents with my music. And now in my 40s, I already find myself criticizing the music that my six-year-olds like and listen to because it's not what I'm familiar with. And I think that what I grew up with is better. And that works across every single medium, obviously, not just music. It works with entertainment. It works with talking about growing up without social media and all of these different things. So it kind of harkens to what Kevin said, which is that people become very comfortable with what they're used to. They become comfortable with the systems and things that they like because there's a fear that you're going to get left behind or that something will replace it and you won't understand it. And the good aspects of Bitcoin are really endless. There are so many ways that it's superior to the systems that we have. You can send it faster than you can send normal money. Any adult knows, and the child doesn't know yet, but if you try to send a wire transfer to someone in a foreign country, it's going to be really expensive. It's going to take a really long time. If you want to send a little bit of money to your friend, if you're five, to anywhere in the world, you can do that almost instantaneously with Bitcoin or a stable coin. So having a kid try that, I think, would be a really amazing experience for them to see that you don't need somebody to tell you where you can send your money and when you can do it, and that you shouldn't have to pay someone to be able to do that. Any five-year-old can probably already see that something's more expensive than when they were three, right? Especially in this environment. We talk about it in my house all the time. Well, milk at the beginning of 2020 was a dollar cheaper than milk is already in 2021. Why is that? Well, it's because our money is becoming worth less. Bitcoin doesn't become worth less. You don't need to get into the technical reasons or deflation to explain that to a child. You just say your money is becoming worth less every year and Bitcoin is not. It's going up in value, which means you can buy more toys and buy more stuff.
Now let's stop there and focus on something that Scott has mentioned. He's just said that if you want to send money to another country using a bank wire or bank transfer, this can one, take a long time, and two, it can be really expensive. Now this might not sound like such a big issue, but if you send a majority of the money you make each month, this is a big problem. And an even bigger problem is if you don't have a bank account, it makes it even harder for you to send the money. So in the United States, 6% of people don't own a bank account. That might not sound like a lot, but it makes up over 14 million people. And in Turkey, that percentage is 31%. So what do people without bank accounts do when they need to send money to different places around the world? Well, normally they'll send money in a different way. They'll go to a company and that company will do it for them. Maybe they'll work abroad and need to send money to their family. The issue is the price these companies charge is really high, sometimes as much as 8% of what you're looking to send. And this is why Scott's mentioned Bitcoin. There is no fee to receive Bitcoins, and many wallets let you control how large a fee to pay when spending. The cost to send Bitcoin is the same, whether you send one Bitcoin or 10, or just a fraction of a Bitcoin anywhere in the world. And not only that, it also makes it almost immediate and saves you and the person you're sending money to time. Overall, Bitcoin gives a lot of people opportunities to help businesses and help individuals. If you found this useful, I'm gonna pass the challenge on to you to share this video with family or friends or anyone that might find it useful. I'm sure there are definitely questions that you still want answered. So share your thoughts in the comments, and also you can ask Alex in the description box below. If you haven't already, make sure to like the video and subscribe to not miss future videos like this.